About this as a story, and we're going to start at the beginning. And the beginning of the story is where we all start, which is as aquatic creatures growing in the womb. And every baby on Earth is born pre-polluted. And by that, what I mean is that when we look in babies, when we look at what's found in umbilical cord blood, when we look at amniotic fluid, when we look at baby's urine, we can find hundreds of chemicals there. And in fact, a study that was done more than 10 years ago found hundreds of chemicals, and there were about 45 chemicals that were found in every baby that was examined. Now, when I first read this study, I was a young woman, and I remember telling my husband about this study, and he's not a scientist. And he said to me, non-scientists ask us the best questions, and he said to me, how many chemicals should be there? And I thought about it, and the answer, who knows, right? Just because a chemical's there doesn't mean that it's dangerous. We shouldn't assume that just because a chemical's there, it's causing harm. But we also shouldn't assume that just because it's there, that we're all fine. And when I started talking to some of my colleagues about that, the great Andreas Kortenkamp, who is a professor at Brunel University in London, he's German by descent, and he said to me, German beer is allowed to have 4 ingredients. Why do we have 300 chemicals in amniotic fluid? For a long time, the womb was thought to be a really protected place. So we were pretty ignorant about the fact that what mom did during pregnancy would affect the health of her offspring. And it wasn't until we saw examples like alcohol. Fetal alcohol syndrome has been described for literally centuries, but it wasn't studied until the 1950s. The idea that drugs could pass through the placenta wasn't really understood until the 1950s and 60s, and hormones passing from mom to the baby wasn't really appreciated until the 1970s. So in the grand scheme of all of science, this is relatively new knowledge that the womb is not actually a protected place. So I'd like you to imagine what was going on in the 1940s. Think globally. Think about what was going on out in the world. And there was this idea that if you could create synthetic hormones, you could make superhumans. A lot of this work was being done in Europe, and a lot of it was really being done by Germany, and then there was kind of an arms race of chemists to try to develop synthetic chemicals that could act like hormones. And at the time, this is estradiol is the native estrogen that our bodies make naturally. These other two chemicals were explored for their use as synthetic estrogens. One was taken off the chemical shelf and used as a pharmaceutical, that's DES, and I'm going to tell you the DES story quickly. And the other was put back on the chemical shelf until the 1950s when it started to be used in consumer products, and that's BPA. So diethylstilbestrol, starting in the 1930s and 40s, was prescribed to women for a range of different outcomes, mostly hormonally based. So if you were having hot flashes during menopause, your doctor would give you DES. If you didn't want to become pregnant, your doctor would give you DES. Once you were pregnant, your doctor would give you DES. And this is an advertisement from an OBGYN journal advertising a drug that contained diethylstilbestrol. And what this ad says, in case you can't read it, is it was prescribed to women to prevent spontaneous miscarriage, spontaneous abortion. And it was under this mistaken idea that if some estrogen is good for you during pregnancy, then surely more must be better. And promised women bigger and stronger babies too. There was no evidence behind that. In fact, it was clear in hindsight that this was just made up. And while it was originally prescribed to women who were at risk for having a miscarriage because they'd had one previously, it became prescribed as routine prophylaxis. So it was put in prenatal vitamins. And women were given DES without ever realizing that they had been given DES. Now, in this audience, you already know the punchline to the story, at least some of you do. But somewhere between 2 and 10 million pregnant women were prescribed DES in the US alone. That's a big range, and we don't know the exact number why, and I'll explain in a second. But in 1971, there were 6 young girls seen in the office of Dr. Albert Herbst at Massachusetts General Hospital in Boston. And they had a very rare cancer of the vagina. And one of the girl's mothers said to Dr. Herbst, "Is this because of that pill that I took when I was pregnant?" And he said, "Probably not." But he started to ask the mothers, and they had all taken DES. And so in 1971, the results of their work was published in the New England Journal of Medicine, and DES was then banned. Now, between 2 and 10 million pregnant women were prescribed DES, and you can imagine that a lot of women in the 1940s, 50s, 60s, 70s were given something by their doctor and told, take this pill, and they did it, right? That's my grandmother's age, and my grandmother would never question a doctor. So in the end, they don't know whether or not they were given DES. And there's a great book called Hormonal Chaos that's written by Sheldon Krimsky, and he's a medical ethicist. And he writes about how there were floods and fires in medical records offices all over the U.S. because doctors didn't want to be sued for having prescribed women DES. So DES really is part of the story of a whole field of science that's referred to as DOAD, or the Developmental Origins of Health and Disease. And the idea is that if you are in a safe, comfortable, protected womb, then you will grow up to be a healthy adult. But if something happens to you during a critical window of development, it can set you up for disease later on. Now those DES daughters, they were born looking entirely normal. It wasn't until they reached puberty that it was clear that they were going to have an increased risk of this vaginal cancer, and it wasn't until they reached the ages of 40, 50, and 60 that it became clear that they would also have increased risk of breast cancer. So these aren't babies that were born with a birth defect, at least not a visible one. The same is true for children of the Dutch famine. So this was also a story of World War II, where there was a blockade and food was restricted to the Netherlands, and women were pregnant, some of them, and were gestating babies sometimes on only 600 or 800 calories a day. So during that famine, those women were giving birth to babies that were exceptionally malnourished and they were tiny. And that still happens in some places on Earth. And if those babies grow up in an environment with limited resources, they're actually quite healthy. They learn to thrive in a limited environment. But that did not happen in Holland, just as it does not happen here in the US. They instead had that famine end. They grew up in the same kind of world that you and I have, where calories are plentiful. And babies that were malnourished in the womb became adults who were more likely to be obese, more likely to have heart disease, more likely to have strokes, more likely to have cancer. What had happened to them in the womb had trained their bodies to prepare for starvation. So when they grew up in a world with plenty of calories, they ate everything that they could get their hands on without knowing it. It's not a conscious choice. It's a change in the physiology of their bodies. So what we know, and I'm trained as an endocrinologist and a developmental biologist, what we know is that every organ is developing at a different period of time in life. And my favorite organ, which is the mammary gland, since I do rodents, they don't have breasts, they have mammary glands, but same thing, same job, is that that is an organ that is developing when you're in the womb. It's developing again when you go through puberty. It's developing again when you're pregnant. It's developing again when you lactate. It's developing again when you go through menopause. So this is an organ that we expect will be especially sensitive to environmental insults, the equivalent of starving in the womb, at different points in our life. So as an endocrinologist, I'm really interested in this class of chemicals that we refer to as endocrine disrupting chemicals, or EDCs. You'll see that on some of my slides. And these are chemicals, and the word exogenous just means they're things that aren't created in our bodies naturally, so things we're exposed to in the environment that can disrupt the actions of hormones. And when I'm talking about hormone action, I'm talking about chemicals that can mimic the action of hormones, so they sort of mimic estrogen, or they mimic androgen. They can block the actions of normal hormones, so they prevent your natural estrogen from doing its job. They can prevent hormones from being synthesized, so you don't have the right levels in your blood. They can alter how your body excretes hormones, so they alter what the levels are. Either you're excreting too much or you're not excreting enough. But in some way, they're changing the physiology of the body at the level of hormones. And what you're going to hear from my lovely colleagues here is a much more in-depth story about all of the different sources, all of the different ways that we're exposed to these endocrine disrupting chemicals. But the thing is that we're not aware of the fact that we're being exposed to these every day in a lot of the things that we're doing. So when I talk to young people, and I won't torture you with this exercise, but normally I ask them to think about how many personal care products did they use today? Like, show me on your fingers how many personal care products. And they normally do that, right? So, and then I remind them that when we're talking about personal care products, we're talking about shampoo, conditioner, soap, deodorant, toothpaste, lotion, hair gel, right? All of these things that we're using on autopilot without thinking about them. And I really hope that my students are using at least toothpaste and deodorant before they come chat with me. So scientists for decades have been working on this question of whether environmental chemicals, is there enough evidence to conclude that environmental chemicals and endocrine disruptors in particular could actually be affecting health? And in 2012, there was an expert review by scientists from around the world, and they drew a handful of conclusions. This report is available online. You can download it. There's also a shorter version of the report that's an executive summary. It is written, the executive summary is written for lay audiences, for public health decision makers. And so I recommend that you find it and read it if you're at all interested. And I would be happy to share links to these things if it's helpful. But what conclusions were drawn from that report in 2012, which to me feels like yesterday, but time is already passing quickly, is that there is sufficient evidence to conclude that endocrine disrupting chemicals can affect the health of people, they affect the health of wildlife animals, and we can study them exceptionally well in laboratory animals. Now, it's my job today to present to you a very quick overview of what we know about endocrine disrupting chemicals and their associations with diseases. And of course, I'm going to focus more on breast health. And a lot of the evidence that we can uncover does not actually come from human populations. And the reason why, if you think back three or four slides, is that usually we're exposed to environmental chemicals early in life and we have no idea what they are. And we get diseases later on in life and we have no idea what we were exposed to 5 years ago, or 10 years ago, or 50 years ago, in order to draw good conclusions. So we're limited in human studies. We have lots of information from laboratory animals. Very little information from wildlife about breast health. Lots about other things like fertility and metabolic syndrome. And if you're interested in those things, that WHO report will help you read about some of those things. But in wildlife, we're mostly looking at fish and frogs, and they just don't have breast tissue, so there's not such interesting things to find from them. So the chemical that most of you have probably at least heard of, and maybe you have no idea why you've heard about it, people who are my age who start to have children start to hear about BPA when they go to Babies R Us to do their baby registries, because everything is now labeled BPA-free. And so you might not be thinking about what this chemical is or what it does, you're just seeing BPA-free and assuming that that's a good thing. So BPA is a chemical that is widely used in consumer products. Plastics, consumer plastics, in particular reusable plastic containers. Also the linings of food cans. If you put your hand in a can and it feels slippery, a lot of those food cans contain BPA. Some dental materials and other medical equipment contains BPA. Sports equipment, I took off the picture because my students don't know what they are anymore, but CDs and DVDs, those are made with BPA. Time passes so quickly. Thermal receipt paper, it's really only been known for about 10 years that thermal receipt paper contains BPA. And in fact, it's quite different than other products where when we drink, these plastic bottles don't have BPA in them, but when we drink out of a reusable plastic water bottle, we're exposed to very, very small amounts that are leaching just by using them in the way that they're intended to be used. But thermal paper, BPA is being sprayed on paper the same way you would shake baby powder onto paper, which means that we're very easily picking it up onto our skin. And if you think that your skin is meant to protect you from chemicals, that's true for some chemicals, But remember that we give people patches so that they can quit smoking, or patches so that they can use birth control. And those chemicals have a very similar property as BPA. So we absorb it quite easily through our skin. So I'm going to tell you about the rodent mammary gland, which is, again, my favorite organ. And the mouse is one of these amazing creatures that has a whole bunch of mammary glands, which means that from experimenting on a single animal, which I know makes some people uncomfortable and is not my favorite thing to do, but is important because otherwise we're experimenting on ourselves the way we pretty much did with DES. From one animal, we get 10 mammary glands, which means we can get a tremendous amount of information from a single animal. And so the mammary glands are lined up on the ventral surface of the animal. And this is what you'll see in farm animals where they just basically have babies all lined up nursing off of them. They can nurse 10 babies at once. And the mammary gland, I like to think about it as a developing tree. And so when we're born, that tree is a very tiny little twig of a tree. And when we reach puberty, you start to see these bulb-like structures. They look like Q-tips or light bulbs at the ends of the ducts. Those are highly proliferative structures. Those are the cells that are going to be rapidly dividing in order to push those ducts through the surrounding fat pad. When the animal reaches adulthood, the ducts are fully filled inside the fat pad, and the mammary gland looks like a wintertime tree, just branches. And it's not until the female becomes pregnant that the mammary gland starts to change again. And in that change, it looks like a summertime tree. And the reason why is that all of those cells that are in the mammary gland have to divide and produce the structures that will eventually make milk. After lactation is complete, those cells that made milk will die. They'll be resorbed into the body, and you'll end up with what looks again like a springtime tree. We know from lots of animal studies that there are several periods in our life where we are sensitive to environmental chemicals. And I mentioned that earlier, this idea that the mammary gland, unlike some other tissues, is developing throughout our lives. So it is developing when we're in the womb. That's how we create the mammary gland to begin with. It develops entirely differently during puberty, during pregnancy, during lactation, during the involuting period when we wean our babies, and then again when we hit menopause. And there's a lot of research that has sort of connected the dots about what is happening in individual cells and cell types inside the mammary gland at those different periods of life and why they might be sensitive to endocrine disrupting chemicals, which is what I'm going to really focus on for the rest of my talk. So this is a study that's now more than 10 years old, where we were looking at animals that had been exposed to BPA in the womb, and we were looking at them when they were still fetuses. So what is happening to the development of the mammary gland during the period of exposure? Now, mind you, these are doses that are in the range of what people are actually exposed to. So unlike the way we often hear about chemical studies, like, oh, of course that did this terrible thing to an animal because they, you know, they force feed this chemical to animals and then the animal's just dying. So of course their mammary gland looks terrible. Here we're looking at doses that are in the range of what people are actually exposed to. And there are chemicals that are, this chemical is administered in the part per billion concentration. So an image I'd like you to think of to conceptualize how small the amount of chemical is that can cause these effects is the equivalent of about a tablespoon of water in an Olympic-sized swimming pool. Now, that sounds like a tiny amount. It sounds like homeopathy, but it's not, because the amount of estrogen that it takes to develop a mammary gland is like a teaspoon in an Olympic-sized swimming pool. So these are small concentrations when we think about them in that context, but they're actually not small concentrations when we think about them like hormones. Now, this is the mouse mammary gland when it hits puberty, and those are those bulb-like structures that I told you about. They look like Q-tips or light bulbs. And what we see is that the mouse that's exposed to BPA looks different in two ways. One is that the ducts are shorter. They haven't grown as far as the control. And the second is there are a lot more of these bulb-like structures. And the reason why that's important is that these bulb-like structures are highly sensitive to carcinogens. So this animal is exposed to carcinogens in its diet, in walking around in the world, getting a little UV irradiation, then it will be highly sensitive and more sensitive than the control animal. These are animals that were exposed only in the womb to those low doses of BPA. And now looking at them in early adulthood, I don't even really have to explain to you what you're trying to see here, but you can tell that this is a wintertime tree, and that's what a wintertime tree should look like, the control. And on the right-hand side, the BPA-exposed animal, you see what looks kind of like a springtime tree, that something is changing. And this gets worse as the animal gets older. So if you take this animal on the right that was exposed to BPA in the womb and then never exposed again, and you took that to a veterinary pathologist, they would tell you, aha, this is a young pregnant female, but she's not. So her physiology has been permanently changed because of what happened to her in the womb. And just like with DES, all of these effects are happening after the exposure has occurred. The male mammary gland is also sensitive. So for those of you who are interested, there are not really good rodent models to study male breast cancer. There's also not a lot of political will to study male breast cancer, which is really unfortunate because there are definitely pockets of areas, if we think about what happened at Camp Lejeune and some other military sites where people are exposed to environmental chemicals that we don't even really know what they were, and people are exposed at different parts of their life because we have soldiers who are stationed there when they're young men, we have older men who are stationed who are sort of lifelong military men, and we have their children who are exposed. And we see pockets of male breast cancer in those areas. Here, what we see is that male mice exposed to low levels of BPA during early development have abnormal mammary gland development when they reach adulthood. They have these sort of huge, overgrown mammary glands. We've seen precancerous lesions inside the mammary glands of these animals. So these are sort of things that your doctor, if it showed up in a biopsy, would raise a red flag, but they wouldn't do any real intervention yet. But we've seen palpable tumors and also ductal carcinoma in situ. So actionable changes in the mammary glands of these animals. And the only thing in the case of these animals that they've been exposed to are low levels of BPA during early development. And some of these palpable tumors are frank carcinomas. So this chemical, at least in some strains of rodents, and they may be sensitive strains, just like some of us may be sensitive people, in some strains of rodents, BPA alone is sufficient to induce a carcinoma. We also can look at what happens if you're exposed to BPA early in life, and then you encounter a very low level of something else in the environment, like a chemical carcinogen. And what we see is that animals that are exposed to BPA early in life get more mammary tumors, and they get them earlier than they would if they had not been exposed to BPA. So it's sensitizing them to these chemical carcinogens. Now, the unfortunate thing is that many of you, if you're aware of BPA, became aware of it because of this BPA-free label that's slapped on all kinds of consumer products, right? You've seen BPA-free everything. I laughed. I went to the grocery store once and saw a sticker on a watermelon that said BPA-free. I'm like, and how do you know? And the problem is that BPA really was the tip of the iceberg, that chemical companies really used it as a marketing tool to sell plastic crap to us. By saying that it was BPA-free, we assumed that it meant that it was safer. And what we're finding now is that often BPA was replaced by other chemicals that have similar actions, similar chemical structures. So the structure for BPA is shown on the left, and the structure for bisphenol S is shown on the right. They look the same, right? And the first study to show that bisphenol S is estrogenic, just like bisphenol A, was published in 2013. And at the time, a reporter called me, and he said, Laura, I'm not a chemist, but wouldn't you think something called bisphenol S would act like bisphenol A? And I said, Ryan, I'm not a chemist, but yes. And we know that bisphenol S is being used in a lot of consumer products. It's found in canned food. It's found in plastic baby bottles and other plastic goods. It's become the major replacement for BPA in thermal receipts, and it's also been detected in personal care products. And while BPA levels appear to be holding or maybe decreasing in the population, BPS levels are starting to increase. So in the early 2000s, only about 25% of us had detectable levels of bisphenol S in our urine, and that's gone way up to 70 to 80% now. My lab just published a study showing that BPS does pretty much exactly like what BPA does. When you are a young animal, it alters the development of the mouse mammary gland. And when you are a young adult, you've seen pictures that look like this before. We're changing the appearance of the mammary glands. What's different between bisphenol S and bisphenol A is that we're also seeing those bulb-like structures that should only be there in puberty. They're sticking around in these adult animals. And what we think that means is that we're going to be extending the period of time in which the BPS-treated animals are sensitive to chemical carcinogens. That's something we still need to test, but the data are certainly suggestive that that might be the case. We also know that adult females that are exposed to BPS when they're pregnant, it affects their ability to lactate. So they have less developed mammary tissue. Their mammary glands are not producing those kind of cells that are needed in order to make milk, and their babies are smaller because of that. The tobacco industry folks would tell you some people want a smaller baby, but you don't want a smaller baby. We also have been using the mouse mammary gland as a way to test the effects of chemical mixtures. So this is a collaboration that my lab did with Dr. Susan Nagel, who's at the University of Missouri, and she's studying chemical mixtures that are used in the fracking process. So these are mice exposed to low levels of a 23 chemical mixture. They're exposed, again, only during early development, and then we look to see what happens to them at puberty and then in young adulthood. And just to remind you, in case you're wondering, like, what chemicals are we talking about when we're talking about fracking? That in order to release gas, natural gas from underground, wells are drilled downward, and then they go to the side, and then they create these fissures, and that's how we release natural gas from deposits deep in the ground. But in order to promote the release of natural gas, water is pushed down along with sand and mixtures of chemicals. And the exact mixtures of chemicals are proprietary information. There's somewhere around 50,000 gallons of chemical that are pumped into every single well of this mixture of chemicals, because there's somewhere around 2 million gallons of water that are pumped into every well. So the water is pumped down. The sand helps hold open the fissures. That allows the natural gas to be released from those fissures. And then up it all comes in this slurry of chemical. And even if all of that water were collected, it's not like we live in this magical place where you can then bury that water and it won't ever affect another living creature again. The world doesn't work like that. So this is the mixture of chemicals, mostly not terribly interesting to you, although maybe you have a favorite chemical that's on that list. What we do know from work in Dr. Nagel's lab is that those chemicals individually have hormonal activity. Most of them actually have hormonal blocking activity. So they block the action of estrogen, they block the action of progesterone, they block the action of thyroid hormone, they block the action of glucocorticoids. So one might think that that's actually good for the mammary gland, but we should know by now that mucking with the endocrine system, there is no good way to do that, right? Mimicking estrogen or blocking the actions of estrogen, either way, is going to affect the health of the mammary gland. So what we saw in the adult females are modest but significant changes in the structures of the mammary gland, changes in cell division in the mammary gland, so we're promoting cell division by this chemical mixture, which of course the promotion of cell division is always something that cancer biologists worry about, and we're inducing again these weird structures that look like those bulb-like structures, so again cells that would be hypersensitive to chemical carcinogens. And when we dissect those weird-looking structures, we saw things no mammary gland biologist has ever described before. And these are precancerous lesions that are already forming at the tips of the ducts. So these are young adults. We have a second cohort of animals we're evaluating right now to follow them to see, is there something adverse? Is there an actual cancer that will arise later on in the lives of these animals? So I just wanted to touch upon, because I know a lot of people think about this, that when we're talking about the environment, we're not ignoring genes. Right, so genes are still very important, and in the breast cancer field, a lot of people are aware of the BRCA genes, but there are other gene mutations that are important for the health of the breast. And most of those genes get attention because what they do is to promote the repair of DNA. If DNA gets damaged, the BRCA protein goes in and helps stabilize damaged DNA and fix it. So if you have a mutation in BRCA, it prevents that from happening, so you end up with more DNA damage. Well, we know that women who have BRCA mutations are at greater risk for breast cancer than the general background population. But most women who get breast cancer do not have BRCA mutations. They don't have family history, which means that there is this important component of environment. And I'm not saying most, like 50, 51%. 90 to 95% of women who get breast cancer do not have a family history and do not have a genetic mutation. For those women that do, though, rodents are going to tell us a story about their increased sensitivity also to environmental factors. So these are mice that we're looking at sections through their mammary gland, and at the bottom are the wild-type mice. So these are normal, genetically normal mice. And these animals over here were exposed to BPA, and this is not a normal-looking piece of tissue. There are more cells there than there should be. So there's an increased cell division, so already an abnormality. These mice up here are BRCA mutants. So just like women who would have a BRCA mutation. What the researchers in this study found is that the BRCA mutants were hypersensitive to BPA. It made them more responsive. It caused greater damage in their mammary glands. So we're not separating the environment from genetics. These two things are both important. And having a genetic predisposition to cancer might mean that you are someone who should be even more concerned about your environment, not thinking, I don't need to worry about that because I got a problem of my own. So I just want to end by telling you a little bit about what we do know from humans, because we can't do a lot of these studies on humans because we don't know what we were exposed to in the womb. And I'm a fairly young woman, but my mom doesn't know what I was exposed to in the womb, and she didn't grow up in the age of just take what a doctor tells you to take. So it's just too long ago to think about reasonably what was I exposed to. So DDT, those of you who know sort of the history of DDT, know that this was a chemical that was widely used to help control pest populations, mostly mosquitoes. And it was used largely in developing countries to help with malarial control, but started to be used just for mosquito control. And where it was once used for crop protection and sort of out in the world, it came into people's homes. So it was infused in wallpaper in people's houses. It was sprayed into products that you would hang in your children's bedrooms, like mosquito nets. It could be added to paper that people used to put inside their kitchen cabinets. At least my grandma used to put, the liner inside the kitchen cabinets. And I have friends who grew up in the 1960s and 70s who can tell stories about when the DDT truck would come and spray in their neighborhood, that they would go play in the spray. Mm-hmm. So people who, because it was clearly safe if you're spraying it on the beach where children are playing, so they would go play in it. It would come spray near orchards, and they would go play or ride their bikes in the spray behind this truck. And so DDT got a lot of attention because we know that it builds up in food chains and because it ended up killing the bald eagle population. And the reason why it destroyed the bald eagle population is that it causes eggshell thinning. So the bald eagles or birds of prey would sit on their nests, they would crush their own babies to death, then the population crashes. And so, and of course, for America, we care about eagles. We might not care about people, but we care about eagles. And so we banned DDT. And the bald eagle population has been rebounding. It still has not hit the level that it it was at before the DDT ban. Now, DDT was banned before I was born. It was banned in the 1970s. And there's almost certainly DDT in my body, just like there's almost certainly DDT in the body of every person in this room, because it builds up in fat. So if you've ever eaten a piece of cheese, then you probably ate some DDT in that cheese or milk. DDT at one point was found in every single meal that was served in a prison. So that was work that Rachel Carson did, and she was the one who sort of shed light on DDT and similar chemicals. It's only recently that we've been able to go to registries where information was collected about what people were exposed to when they were very young, in this case, splitting them up by age. How old were you in 1945 when DDT started to be sprayed? If you're very young, the more DDT that was sprayed where you live, the more likely you were to get breast cancer. And then a more recent study done by Barbara Kahn in California, they actually looked at blood that was stored from babies that were born at a period of time, measured how much DDT was in their blood, and found that the children whose mothers had DDT in their body before they were born, the more in their body, the more likely the daughters were to have breast cancer. So this is one of the few human studies that can look at this sensitive period of development in the womb and show that it, in fact, affects the health of offspring. We've also gotten tremendous insights from those DES daughters, right? This is a known exposure, at least for some women. We know some were definitely exposed, we know some were definitely not exposed, and then there's some women who just have no idea. But when we look at those women who were definitely exposed, we can see that they had this increased risk of vaginal cancer that was usually detected young. They had an increased risk of infertility, often because they had malformations of their reproductive tracts. And that they would have an increased risk of breast cancer when they reached the age that breast cancer is more common. And they would have daughters who would suffer from infertility. And they would have daughters who are at increased risk for certain cancers. So the DES granddaughters are also affected by that pill. And we have no idea how many generations this effect is going to last. In humans, we just have to wait, right? It's not like mice where I can produce 3 generations in a year. With humans, we just have to wait to see until we can collect enough data to see how far these effects are going to go. So I often hear this quote when I give this talk. Maybe not in an audience like this, but I often hear this quote. We've all been exposed to these things, and we're all fine, right? Like, why are you telling me this? I am absolutely fine. And if by fine you mean that I was born with 10 fingers and 10 toes, that's true. But we are seeing increases in all kinds of diseases and conditions around the world. Some of these, you could say, are due to changes in diagnostic criteria, right? So we know that we are diagnosing more breast cancers because we have better therapies to be able to do that. We have better detection systems. Even that does not account for the increased incidence of breast cancer in developed countries. Same thing with things like ADHD and autism. We've changed how we diagnose it. Even that cannot account for the increase in the incidence that we're seeing in human populations. When we look at populations around the world, at the top is a graph illustrating testicular cancer rates. This is not a diagnosis issue. You have testicular cancer or you don't. The diagnosis has not changed. And this can be a very deadly cancer, and it's usually detected in very young men. And looking largely at Scandinavian countries, there's been an increase, a pretty rapid increase over a short period of time in the number of men with testicular cancer. The graph on the bottom is breast cancer, where you can see a consistent pattern across countries of the world where the incidence is increasing. We are not all fine. The age at which girls go through puberty has declined over time. And that's not just puberty related to when they start their menstrual cycle, it's also puberty of the breast. And we know that the timing of puberty is a risk factor for breast cancer in women. The earlier you go through puberty, the longer period of time of your life you'll be exposed to your own estrogen, the greater your risk factor. So this shift whether it's because of BPA or hormones in milk or increased obesity, it's environmental and it's changing the health of young girls. So I'm going to just acknowledge the people who work for me because they're so adorable. And then I'm going to pass this microphone off to the lovely Laura Weinberg.
Good evening, everybody. I'm really just honored to be here, and especially right after Laura Vandenberg. So I want to start with. Okay, so my job here is to explain to you what all the different exposures that Dr. Vandenberg explained, and I didn't go into depth about how you're exposed to it and what safer alternatives you can choose and make choices. So that's something that I'm going to share with you in the next session. All right, first of all, I got involved in this work because I was very concerned about, right in my neighborhood, there were many women being diagnosed with breast cancer, and many of them didn't have a family history. So what I soon found out was just what Dr. Vandenberg said, was that less than 10% of all breast cancer incidents is due to family history or genetics. Then I also found out that studies show that women carrying the inherited gene BRCA1 and BRCA2, they found that breast cancer age by 50 was 24% for those born after 1940, but it increased 67% for those, that those born before 1940 had less of a risk than those born after 1940, where there was a 67% risk. It could be attributed to the Industrial Revolution that took place after the 40s when all of these chemicals then came on the marketplace. And then there are chemicals, as Dr. Vandenberg explained, that I became concerned about that were classified as possible, probable, or known carcinogens and endocrine disruptors. Also, the whole issue about body burn-in, that these chemicals are being detected in our bodies, as Dr. Vandenberg said, and also it's documented by the Center for Disease Control. And then there's this, also this issue about windows of susceptibility, where our breast tissue are more sensitive to carcinogens during the neonatal period, the early childhood period, prepubescent, pubescent, and also during pregnancy. So what is the story with these chemicals? And what we know is that only 7% or 200 chemicals in the marketplace have been adequately tested for toxicity or chronic disease. And that also only 7 chemicals out of 100,000 have been banned in the United States. Actually, the reason this is that many of them, or most of them actually, were grandfathered in the 1970s, and that's when EPA was not really looking for toxicity, and so they just remained on the market. And it is extremely hard to take off one of these chemicals off the marketplace. Karen Miller and I have actually successfully did that with BPA in children's baby bottles and sippy cups in 2010. We were part of other groups around New York State, and we really forged ahead. But it was really no easy task. So just to get one off the market, even it's not even totally off the market, obviously, just in that particular, in those particular products. So what I'm going to discuss today is this menu, and it's pesticides, artificial athletic turf, heavy metals, cleaning products, and air fresheners, cosmetics, scented candles, nonstick cookware, plastics, PBDEs, which are flame retardants, and PAHs, polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, which is found in a combusted fuel and cigarette smoke. Okay, so regarding pesticides, this is now the time of year when there's more exposure to pesticides because people are concerned about their lawn care and all kinds of flowers. And so this is a very interesting study that took place in Cornell University where they showed that if a mowing height is higher, that it actually shades the weed seed. So you'll see on the right-hand side, the mowing height is at 1.5 inches, and there's a lot of dandelions there. As it increases 2 inches and then 2.5 inches, the dandelions start to disappear because the higher blades of grass are actually shading the weed seeds. Other things that we can do is leave the grass clippings on the lawn because actually that enriches the soil, it adds nitrogen to the soil. We can use bio-based products in order to get rid of insects and other diseases on plants. And there is an abundance of these types of products today, whereas when I first started this work 25 years ago, you really had to search very hard for them. Okay, so for indoors, we also use insecticides. And what we can do instead of using them, we can make the environment inhospitable or inaccessible to pests. Because pests need three things in order to survive. They need shelter, they need water, and they need food. So if we remove those sources, then the chances are that we will not have these insects coming into our homes. I'll give you a brief example of this, and that is you can become a private investigator, let's say at this time of year, when ants start marching into your home. And so last year, I walked into my kitchen and I saw ants swarming all over the place. And normally, back 30 years ago, I would have screamed, called somebody in, maybe my husband, I don't know. I'd start with him first and, you know, get out all the different cans and start spraying or calling someone. Totally out of control feeling. But instead, what I did, I got out my vacuum cleaner and I vacuumed up all the ants and then I watched to see where the next one came. And the next one came around this basket that I had that had some maple syrup on it. I lifted up the basket, voila, tons of ants having a maple syrup party. So after that, I vacuumed those up and I took out a product called Orange Guard, which is orange peels. It's in liquid form, which is orange peels and it actually repels bugs, ants. And you can order it online. And that repelled any of the ants, and the problem was gone. So I patted myself on the back and said, wow, I didn't have to call anybody. And my family's tired of hearing me about these proud moments that I have. But, you know, listen, I avoided having toxic pesticides in my home, and those ants didn't return. Other things that you can do is you can cement cracks and crevices, install door sweeps, add weather stripping to windows, repair window screens to keep out the mosquitoes, and use least toxic pesticides, meaning boric acid and things of that nature, instead of using fogs and bombs and all other kinds of things that people do resort to, when you can do so many other things instead of that. All right, then another thing that I came across, which was quite interesting, but not really too wonderful, was that on most pesticide labels, there's something called inert ingredients. Has anybody ever heard of inert ingredients?
Nothing.
Inert ingredients, you'd usually think that is something that is inactive. But in this case, at least 90% of most pesticide formulas have inert ingredients that are even more toxic or just as toxic as the active ingredients. And the reason that is that they're trade secrets for competitive reasons so that manufacturers don't copy each other's secret formula. So basically, the secret is on us because they have a do a process called reverse engineering, and they can find out what's in the other pot. Anyway, but I want to make you aware of that you know, it may have something like, sounds like a floral arrangement, like pyrethrins, and they say that that's like crushed flowers, and I mean, that it really, what that is that it's a chemical preparation. So you want to make sure that when you look at the ingredients, that you also check to see about the inner ingredients. Look for labels that say OMRI, Organic Material Review Institute, and that shows that it doesn't have any of these chemicals. So the preventive approach for crawling pests: avoid chemicals called organophosphates, synthetic pyrethroids, pyrethrins. And by the way, Karen Miller and I were going to put our PowerPoint on our website so you can refer to this, so you don't have to memorize all these great names. The better products to use: boric acid powder, boric acid gel, silica aerogel, diatomaceous earth, which actually I do have someone apply diatomaceous earth around the perimeter of my home, because what that is fossilized shells, very sharp. It acts as a barrier to ants and other crawling pests, because when it crosses the diatomaceous earth, it peels off the outer layer of their bodies, and they dehydrate, and they just don't come into your house. Okay, then other products, safer products. It's called Victor, and there's many, many products on the market. But you have to be very careful, too, of labeling. It may say natural and good earth and all kinds of things. Reading labels is very, very important. Another way that we're exposed to pesticides is through produce. And so this is a list that was created by the Environmental Working Group. And we actually have a handout outside of this list so that you can keep it in your wallet when you go shopping. Okay, so moving along now, I'm going to talk about athletic fields, because athletic fields, today there's a lot of artificial turf where children are playing on athletic fields. And studies shown in Connecticut and New York have cited that the presence of hazardous materials are on these fields. On the fields, there's tires that have been recycled and made into chrome rubber. But the chrome rubber actually contains lead, cadmium, benzene, and other chemicals that have been linked with breast cancer. So also, we tell people that your children should really avoid playing on these fields when the temperature is very hot, because these chemicals can volatilize and go into the atmosphere. And so they're getting that exposure by breathing that in also. All right, so a way to get around some of this is that also skin cuts and abrasions from turf fields are susceptible to infection. Be sure to clean and monitor them, and bandage any turf burns, because these materials get very hot and can actually like cause burns on the children. Remove the rubber pellets from the shoes. It's actually these pellets that I spoke about. And close before leaving the turf fields, and at home, shake out the children's equipment and clothes and socks over garbage, and have your child shower also. All right, now the preventive approach to heavy metals. Lead. So where are we finding lead? People are concerned about finding lead in our water, our tap water. And what you can do is, well, first of all, you can call up your water department and have your water checked. Or you can go to the Environmental Working Group site. I'm going to be mentioning this fabulous site several times because it's so empowering to consumers. And they have a site for evaluating the water in your actual district. And all you have to do is type in your zip code, and up comes whatever contaminants that they have found. And then you can call up your water department and give them a what for. Okay, avoid purchasing costume jewelry for children, because they're in the window of susceptibility that may contain lead. You can call the manufacturer to see if the jewelry contains lead. And also, our Department of Health in New York State tested 103 pieces of costume jewelry for children and found that out of 103, there were 12 that had lead in them. Cadmium. Avoid also purchasing costume jewelry for that reason too, because it can contain that heavy metal. And the whole exposure with this is not necessarily that they wear it on their skin, because I've read through various sites that it doesn't get absorbed through the skin, but young children have a tendency to put the jewelry in their mouths, chew on them, and so this is so common, the hand-to-mouth behavior, that this is an exposure that you want to try to have them avoid. And mercury, choose to eat fish that doesn't contain mercury. Karen Miller's group bought a brochure on how to guide yourself on buying fish that is the least toxic. So on the way out, please check out that handout. Mm-hmm. All right, cleaning products. So all of these products, all-purpose cleaners, disinfectants, glass cleaners, furniture polish, toilet bowl cleaners, oven cleaners, antibacterial cleaners, all of them either contain chemicals that are known or endocrine disruptors or carcinogens. And chemicals of concern are triclosan, which is an endocrine disruptor, and it actually was banned in antibacterial soaps, but it's still in body wash, shampoos. It's an antimicrobial, so it's also in cutting boards and socks. You want to be aware that if something said, if a product says it's got an antimicrobial, that you may want to try to just mix that and move on to a safer product. Phthalates are in cleaning products, also endocrine disruptors, and phthalates are often found in artificial fragrances. And artificial fragrances, it's really a potluck story, because they can have manufacturers can choose at least 3,000 different chemicals to place in fragrances. So it could be anything from really an actual floral extract to something carcinogenic. Alkaphenols. Alkaphenols replaced phosphates in laundry detergents. However, alkaphenols are endocrine disruptors, and when we do our laundry, the alkaphenols actually go into the water supply, and the U.S. Geological Service actually found alkaphenols in lakes and rivers in the United States. Formaldehyde is a known carcinogen. The fact that that's in any product, just it's a known carcinogen, we've all heard of that, and so you know that's something that we want to choose safer cleaners. PERC, or perchloroethylene, that's a very popular chemical used by dry cleaners. So we want to try to look for dry cleaners that are using a process called either wet washing or carbon dioxide, CO2. And the organization Green Inside and Out brought information about dry cleaning. Beth Fitani, that's here, she actually did a whole survey on in Nassau County and Suffolk County on which cleaners are using a safer method other than perchloroethylene. And then paradichlorobenzene, it's a reasonably anticipated carcinogen. It's found in mothballs. So instead of using mothballs, which sticks to your clothing, really stays there for quite a while. I once had to change my seat in a restaurant, I'm not kidding you, because the man next to me obviously took his sweater out of storage. And I said, yeah, we better get up right now, because, you know, we really don't, we don't want to have a secondary exposure. Okay, so what is the preventative approach for all these cleaning products? Well, we're so fortunate today, other than, like I said, 25 years ago when I started doing this work, that certain markets and health food stores have have safer cleaning products. Still, I advise you to read the labels because, you know, here and there things get, you know, stuck in there that may make you wonder what it is. But it's more available today. And also homemade cleaners. I use vinegar a lot in my house. This is something that our grandmothers and great-grandmothers used, and their houses were very clean, as I remember. Baking soda, hydrogen peroxide, orange peels, and lemons. A lot of people make their own concoctions, and I haven't used any conventional cleaning product in 25 years, and my home is really clean. So I will say that. You can also look for these labels in order to give you reassurance. One is the Eco logo, and the other is the Safer Choice label that was designed by the EPA, and they're very scrutinizing that who gets these labels. Okay, for cosmetics, only 11% of 10,000 ingredients in cosmetics have adequately been tested for toxicity. The FDA, the Food and Drug Administration, does not have to approve or review any cosmetics that come to the marketplace. That really shocked me years ago. And I then found out that the only time that they do recall a product is when is a large segment of the population does become ill. An example of that is with a Brazilian hair straightening product that came out years ago with a very high percentage of formaldehyde because it's got a good straightening effect, you know. But that was recalled, and all the salons were in an uproar in saying, you know, now ours are organic, and you ask them for the product name and go online and call up the manufacturer. I've called up manufacturers many, many times and have asked them questions. So, you know, don't be shy about that. It's really a good way to empower yourself. Okay, so what on labels should we look for on cosmetics that are buzzwords that we really should avoid? Fragrance, as I mentioned before, over 3,000 chemicals can be placed in fragrance and be in your cosmetic. And that contains phthalates again, which is an endocrine disruptor. Phthalates are also found in certain lipsticks and certain nail polish. Parabens. There's four different kinds of parabens: ethyl, methyl, butyl, and propylparaben. But it always says paraben, you know, right after those four words. Avoid using nail polish with the chemicals toluene, formaldehyde, and phthalates. A lot of nail salons are privy to that today, and they're trying to have better, safer products on hand. I mentioned triclosan before. But it was banned in antibacterial soaps, but it's still found in certain toothpaste. And they don't want to remove it either. They're saying that it's a good product, and here it's going right in the mouth to people. But I did alert my dentist to this, and he nixed that, like I said. You know, it pays to like talk to all these different people and tell them that you've got this concern. Oxybenzone. Summer is coming, and oxybenzone is the main ingredient in a lot of sunscreens, so we want to try to avoid that. There is zinc preparation and other safer choices. What you can also do, which is a really cool thing to do, is get the app that's called Think Dirty, that the Environmental Working Group designed. And with that app, you can go to a store, you can then scan the barcode of a cosmetic. It will give you a rating system of between 1 and 10, 1 being the least toxic, and you can make your decision on whether or not to purchase that product right on the spot. And when we speak to the students and schools, they love that app, and they love that name.
Think Dirty.
Okay, so green chemistry to the rescue. I got turned on to knowing about green chemists about 10 years ago, and that they were developing substances to safer substances to replace the toxins in all of our products. So their goal is to replace with sustainable substances that are non-toxic for human beings and the environment, and they apply innovative scientific solutions to real-world environmental problems. So in a picture here, we've sent through a program of ours students to green chemistry laboratories, and the students on the bottom right, they actually developed a safer surfactant that is found in shampoos. Surfactants actually create the lather in shampoos and other products. And there's actually toxins in there, 1,4-dioxane is in there, that actually has been found in our water supply. And these students helped develop a safer surfactant than that particular chemical when they were at this lab. So, we've sent students also to Dr. Vandenberg's lab, and between the Huntington Coalition and our coalition, we have sent over 100 Long Island high school students to laboratories comparable to Dr. Vandenberg's lab. Okay, the next chemical exposure is called PFOA. Actually, it's mostly found in non-stick cookware products, and microwave popcorn bags, pizza box linings, and stain-resistant chemicals, and in certain dental floss, I found out. So, what we want to try to do is just replace any of our non-stick products with stainless steel, and then also make popcorn the old-fashioned way with kernels and oil on the stovetop, and really look for floss that doesn't have PFOA, and it's there in a lot of health food stores. Mm. All right, plastics to avoid, recycled numbers, 3, 6, and 7, the triangles on the bottom. I have to move because they're very flexible. Okay, and want to avoid 3, 6, and 7, and as Dr. Vandenberg said, BPA-free doesn't mean bisphenol free. Choose glass or stainless steel instead. Use Pyrex or porcelain to microwave. Use glass containers or stainless steel. Instead of canned foods or baby formulas, buy fresh or frozen produce. Don't handle thermal receipts with BPA. Use wax paper bags instead. That's for the plastic wrap. All right, so excessive handling. You can get electronic receipts, like at Macy's. I get an electronic receipt. Another reason to try to avoid plastics and also to recycle is that what goes in the ocean comes back to us in the fish, and that there are 8 tons of plastic that winds up in the ocean every year, and also by the year of 2050, they expect that there'll be more plastic in the ocean than fish. PBDEs or flame retardants. I have a handout outside on how to purchase furniture with foam in it, because usually the foam has PBDEs, and actually they become airborne, attach to dust, so it's good to have a HEPA filter. Wipe down your counters with wet cloths, and wash your hands frequently. A study found that hand washing reduced office exposures to these chemicals. Here are some websites, but again, you can look on our website in order to find them out. Scented candles have artificial fragrance. Again, we don't know it's an artificial fragrance. And some candles also have lead wicks, and then it's giving off a lead exposure. So beeswax candles, soy-based candles, candles scented with essential oils, or electric candles. PAHs, they can be found in charcoal food. The Long Island Breast Cancer Study Project found a 50% greater risk of breast cancer in women with the highest level of PAHs. So I'm sure none of you stand behind a bus and breathe that in, but sometimes we just have to take some precautions. All right, so additional resources, environmental working group. You can go to their site. They have 80,000 personal care products that they rate, and you can check to see if yours are on there. The Think Dirty app site, National Tap Water Database, what I mentioned before, putting in your zip code. If you decide to get a water filter, I have a water filter in my home. They walk you through their guide on you know, all the details of the right water filter for you. And they also have a Healthy Living Home Guide that walks you through the whole house. Silent Spring Institute, which is not a part of the Environmental Working Group, has something called a Detox Me app, and it's an action kit to test your urine for 10 common household toxins in your body, and then they provide a report. I don't know if you saw that Nicholas Kristof from the New York Times did an opinion piece on this about a month ago, and out of the 10 chemicals, he had 6 in his urine. But you know, he knew then what action to take in order to reduce that or eliminate that exposure. And then there's the precautionary principle that tells us that even without any scientific certainty, because science can never be 100%, that when there is a weight of evidence indicating that there's a reasonable harm caused by these products or chemicals, that we should be able to take precautions either through purchasing or making healthy choices, and also going to our legislators and asking them to help us out and help ban some of these things. Okay, and now partner in crime.
Maybe a shorter mic. I'm gonna do it from here, Laura. Working with these women is a fantastic experience. It's been a great journey. And I'm here actually to talk about being the change, political action, what brought me into this, and what drives me every day. So first we're going to talk about only a fraction of the history of breast cancer, which is really the second feminist movement. So in the 1940s, baby boomers were born into the lifestyle of working moms. I was told by my colleague, Melanie Cabrell, I was born in 1944, and I said to her, I'm a baby boomer. So she said, no, you're not. You're a what?
You're the greatest generation.
What can I tell you? So I missed it by a year. So we wanted to identify ourselves, you know, out of the house, not only being, you know, mothers and caregivers, but we wanted to get a job. And in 1962, there are icons that really awakened women on their action and their voice development. Teresa Lasser had gone to Memorial Sloan Kettering, and she was very unhappy with her surgery. She wasn't informed, she didn't have good conversations with her doctors at the time, and in the end, her experience led to the founding in 1952 for the Reach for Recovery program, which is still in existence today. Betty Friedan wrote The Feminine Mystique, which was and became the seminal event of the feminist movement. That was very controversial. Many women came out and said, how dare you speak against me? I think that a very valuable job is being a mother, a wife, and a caregiver. But it helped women to develop their voices and to be seasoned in their ways of debating. And we realized that, you know, we were a rich tapestry that actually could be the change. And breast cancer was our foundation. In 1970s, publications that initiated the women's health movement, Babette Roseman addressed how medical professionals made the decision on her body. As a matter of fact, at one point, she awakened, her doctor didn't inform her. They said that she had benign lumps. She awakened fully bandaged and realized that she had gotten a Holstead radical. Olmsted Radical, for those of you who don't know, is when they took off the chest wall, not only the breast. My girlfriend actually had a Olmsted Radical. She wasn't advised of that. I was diagnosed in 1987, and I had a modified radical, you know, which is just my right breast. And truth be told, I decided that I would go for no adjunctive therapy at all. I chose only to get a mastectomy. I had no radiation therapy and no chemical therapy. I'll give you another aside. At the hospital that I went to, Laura's heard this, in the city, all of us didn't know each other. The day before, we were all walking the halls, all nervous. We bonded because of the women that came before us. And we formed a group that day, called ourselves the Tit for Tatters. We felt that if we were going to lose a tit, we'd be able to talk about it openly, collectively with each other, and then maybe we would take that show on the road. The Tit for Tatters grew to be over 30 women. We're now down to 3. But we're still out there talking up a storm. Rose Kushner advocated for women to know their options before treatment. The Alliance, the National Alliance of Breast Cancer Organizations, was formed at that time. And then celebrities amplified our concerns. Shirley Temple Black, Betty Ford, Happy Rockefeller, all these women helped to build our voice and build our confidence. In 1980, Andre Lorde, an African-American lesbian poet, published a narrative on why do we need to have construction. And that's another personal story. I decided not to get reconstruction. And so in the 1980s, I was still being challenged, you know, why aren't I doing that? And I told my doctor, I talk so much, nobody looks at me from the neck down. I'm very comfortable with my body. So let's just move on from here. So in the 1990s, politically active organizations focusing on breast cancer emerged across the United States. And at that same time, miraculously, more women were being elected to Congress, and the stage was set for legislative action and policymaking. Many maps began to appear. I think those of you who know about the West Islip group that went door to door, knocking on doors and creating a maps with an index card, and that led to Huntington Breast Cancer saying that we would map the Huntington area. We didn't realize that there were over 200,000 women, and it was 68,000 households. So we became the first GIS mapping of the incidence of breast cancer. It took an organization, a local organization, 9 years, day and night, to map this. We did it with computers that were given to us. We went on free, we did free ads on radio shows. But at the 9-year mark, we were able to release our mapping. That led to New York State doing a mapping of Long Island, and where we discovered that there are certain areas on Long Island that had higher incidence of breast cancer than other areas. Interestingly, those areas that had shown a slightly higher incidence of breast cancer on Long Island, there was no remediation, so we don't quite know what happened to all that effort. And then the Long Island Breast Cancer Study Project, which was a mandated study, and I'll talk about this later on, came up. It was mandated at $50 million. One of the components was to have a federal GIS mapping that never really materialized. So, but when most of these studies, including the Long Island Breast Cancer Study Project, and Laura Weinberg touched on that, she said there were only subsets of people that were exposed to PAHs. I was one of those subsets, you know, I could identify with that. But there was no cause and effect relationship. Again, I'll go into the Long Island Breast Cancer Study Project later because it did have tremendous value. It put women and their voices on the map, tremendous amount of sampling and data has been collected, and it's still being utilized by scientists around the country. And again, we had a seat at the table. So that was one of the first stakeholder meetings that we had. So here's a clicker, and I go on to the next. Okay, so a picture's worth a thousand words. You see at the top, local organizations convened in Washington in 1991. If you look at the bottom slide, these were partnerships. You'll see a Laura Weinberg in that picture, and you'll see people from Babylon and Great Neck and Manhasset and West Islip and Islip and Huntington, all convening with the researchers from Cornell and the National Cancer Institute, and we were convening to talk about the Long Island Breast Cancer Study Project. And the picture in the middle, Laura and I were part of that too, that we had to learn what Laura Vandenberg does, which is like working with animal models. Truth be told there, Laura Weinberg and Karen Miller said, no, we can't do that part of it, but we'll do every other part. So most of the activists that convened at the Fox Chase Cancer Center did do dissection of animal models, right? We did most everything but that, right, Laura?
Yeah, everything but
that. You're going to see a repeat here, no family history. So both Laura's say that 90% of us diagnosed really don't have any family history. And that is very concerning. So Kenneth Olden, who is the director emeritus of the National Institutes of Environmental Health Science, put together some NIEHS money and said we need to look at that. And there was a quote that either he or Judith Stern came up with that says, genetics loads the gun, but the environment pulls the trigger, that it's not about genetics alone. And in 2018, an estimated 330.80 new cases of breast cancer are expected to be diagnosed in the U.S. So we're not there yet. So the Long Island Breast Cancer Study Project, it was a $50 million study looking at potential environmental factors and breast cancer risk in Nassau, Suffolk, and Queens. The study looked at pesticides, PAHs, dieldrin, chlordane, PCBs, and electromagnetic fields. This was a case control study. For those of you who don't know what that means, it means that many hospitals across Long Island provided cases for the researchers to look at. As we would go into the hospital, there were tumor registries. They said, well, here comes Karen Miller, and she's going to have a breast amputation, so there was tissue that could be utilized, there was blood that was taken, there was urine, and then the control would be to find the other through dialing, somebody who was probably my age, who lived around me, and who had not been diagnosed. So it was a case control, study. And like I said, the good part about the Long Island Breast Cancer Study Project was that was a big seat at the table that we had, and the data is still being utilized today. Yes?
But I just want to say that the one flaw that was discussed about the Long Island Breast Cancer Study Project was that you can't go back in time and look at exposures, because those exposures are no longer in these women, or what were in those women. And also, the exposure is sometimes a breakdown into other chemicals called metabolites, and so it's you have a whole different circumstance then. So that was a flaw of the study. However, other studies moved on; they learned from that, and it wasn't for naught, because in the smaller studies within the Long Island Breast Cancer Study Project, they did come out with some positive findings.
Right, and it was also very difficult. The questionnaire was about an hour to an hour and a half. It's very hard to remember what, as Dr. Vandenberg said, your histories, your mother doesn't even know your histories, you know, so you say general things like, I would follow the fog truck, or I do like a green lawn, but that didn't add too much light. So we're all connected in so many ways, and in during the time of the Long Island Breast Cancer Study Project, we were very lucky to meet a Dr. Philip Landrigan at the same time, and I'll speak about that later. The New York State Breast Cancer Network was formed, and we were chairs of the Environmental Committee. And being a chair had a lot of responsibility in the network, but one of the privileges was at the annual meeting in Albany, the chairs could choose who would be the spokesperson for that year. And we chose Dr. Philip Landrigan. It was interesting because Dr. Landrigan is a pediatrician, and a lot of the women with breast cancer said, why are we going to be talking to a pediatrician? What does that in any way, shape, or form have to do with breast cancer? So he brought to light about the windows of susceptibility, that it doesn't start when you're 42, Karen, and you're diagnosed. You know, you had cancer or a trajectory to get cancer long before that. So getting a seat at the table, learning about windows of susceptibility, and the partnerships that we formed through the New York State Breast Cancer Network, through different of the programs that the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences runs, through some things that the NCI are doing, we were able to contribute to the dialogue, which is really, really important, and why I'm here, to try to motivate some of you to get involved in political action and be the change. So in 1998, the New York State Breast Cancer Network was formed. The criteria to get into the network was you needed to be a grassroots community group, you needed to have survivor support and environmental issues on your roster, and we grew to represent over 100,000 women from Buffalo to Long Island, which was quite a big force, and we got a lot of the elected officials' attention. And again, now we had a seat at the table where we could create change in this iron triangle, which has to do with citizen stakeholders, that would be maybe Laura and I, and it had to do with researchers, which has to do with Dr. Vandenberg, and it has to do with elected officials. Things cannot happen if there's not an iron triangle, and we all need an equal seat at the table. We took a better safe than sorry approach, and we addressed the precautionary principle that Laura spoke about. And in 2008, we got the attention of the then New York State governor, and Laura and I were put on a team. We were appointed by the governor to be part of Executive Order Number 4. And what that did, which was very exciting, was we know that when large institutes procure products, they actually can drive down the market. So we presented why these big institutes would buy safer products in paper and other and other technologies. The New York State Breast Cancer Network took on the issue of fracking, and with our California partners, we created a webinar that focused on all the dangers that Dr. Vandenberg spoke about, and that influenced virtually thousands of people. In 2014, Governor Cuomo announced the ban on hydraulic fracturing. So it works. Partnerships, and these are only a few that we came up with, Long Island Neighborhood Network, the Just Green Partnerships, the Citizens Campaign for the Environment, Green Inside and Out, the ICANN School of Medicine, the Witness Project of Harlem, I'll talk about that, the NIEHS Partners, Suffolk County Task Force. We can't do anything without partnerships. So we do things as individuals, we do things in community groups, we do things in partnerships with uncommon partners. In 2003, because of our previous work at a county and a state level, the NIEHS, under the direction of Ken Olden and now Linda Birnbaum, formed what would be a center study model. And they would bring together the best of the best from all over the country. Dr. Vandenberg is part of that for over many years. We've had many iterations. So in the BCERP, Breast Cancer Environmental Research Program, began in 2003. And it went for 7 years. And it focused on early environmental exposures. Again, because I'll repeat what you've been told through our two Lauras, it's about the windows of susceptibility and early exposures. So we really re-emphasize the fact that we can't just discuss breast cancer when we're diagnosed. The BCERP continued as BCERP from 2010 to 2015, and now we were looking at extended exposures. That study, that 5-year study, brought us to the last iteration, which is now ongoing, which is again focusing on the windows of susceptibility, a lot of work to be done, and breast density. HBCAC is a community partner with one of the centers, Michigan State, and this shows you that we actually drive the science, are part of the study, to put together some publications, and we help to translate the study. So basically, Michigan State, in this iteration, is looking at saturated fat from red meat and breast cancer. And what they found out is high ingestion of saturated fat derived from red meat promotes mammary cancer, independent of obesity or overweight. High-fat diet can promote mammary cancer in both adolescence and in adulthood. A high-fat diet restricted to adolescence during puberty promotes later mammary cancer, even if a low-fat diet is maintained during adulthood. And high-fat diet tends to increase the proportion of a triple-negative breast cancer. These studies are really important, and it's really important to have community groups out there with the ability to translate this science so that our neighbors will know exactly what's happening currently. We don't have to wait lifetimes. That's a problem. If we find out within our lifetime, brown eggs are good, don't eat eggs, eat 3 eggs, eat 5 eggs, the whole thing becomes totally confusing. What we try to do, that I'm hoping that you all become involved in, is working with researchers like Dr. Vandenberg, who spoke so articulately, and she can help us to translate the science so that it goes into diverse population, and we can create those changes current, and that's really important. Oops. Yeah, there we go. So, diverse population. Laura and I were very privileged, again, being part of the BCERP, to go into Mount Sinai, the Icahn School of Medicine at Mount Sinai, where they were going to be working with the Witness Project of Harlem, a group of fantastic, powerful, unbelievably educated, wonderful women from Harlem. And we were there to give PowerPoint that we're showing you today. We learned so much from these women. The reason that the Witness Project got together with the advocates and the Breast Cancer Environmental Program was to say each of us needs to be able to talk to our own communities as if in the way that we can hear what those words are. These women went through the program with us for 1 year. At the end of the year, they took their knowledge out to all the women in their area, in Harlem and in New York City. Their work is still ongoing. It's quite phenomenal. I can speak on behalf of both of us. When Laura and I would go, I think it was every couple of weeks or once a month, both of us were charged with being able to provide some information and listen to how it was absorbed and then put back in their own language, and it made sense. It was quite extraordinary. We do have our Guardians of the Future program. 100 of our students have gone through the program. Here's a little snapshot of I think this took place in California just recently. of which our two colleagues were here. Again, while I am encouraging you to please get involved in political change and be the change, it will be with a great deal of responsibility. So once you stand up and say, okay, count me in, there's no end to how many ways you can be counted in. So at one point, we were asked to come up with a Bible that we were going to present to the then Secretary of Health and Human Services, Kathleen Sebelius, in 2012 and 13. And the name of the group was called the IBERSERC, had to be berserk, but it stands for Interagency Breast Cancer and the Environmental Research Coordinating Committee. A group of us were put together, which was very equal. You had 19 people, somebody to break the, to break the vote, right? But there were 6 activists, 6 researchers, and 6 government agencies that spent over 2 years writing this report, which is Breast Cancer and the Environment, Prioritizing Prevention. And if any of you want a copy, please leave your name out there and we'll give you a copy of the executive summary. We'll send it to you. So what can you do to get involved? It only takes 2. Start a committee today, recruit, grow, reach two friends, and then that'll expand. Engage with others, be a good listener. Strength comes in diversity. Start early, develop long-term trusted relationships, and work together as a team. And I'll end with, be the change, Mahatma Gandhi. If anybody has any questions for us, that would be terrific, and thank you.
So we're going to go ahead and do questions on the cards, and we have a really short period of time. So I've gathered a few. So if you have any others, Raina, can you gather the others for me? Thank you. Okay. So one of the questions was, they were saying that in New Jersey, gas is pumped by an attendant. And they were wondering if there was, since we have to pump our own gas here in New York, has there been any attempt to change the laws? Is that an assumption that that is a way that we're taking in toxins by pumping gas?
It's definitely something that could potentially increase your exposure from the perspective of medicine. I worry much more about the people whose profession requires them to do that kind of thing. So it's sort of an environmental justice issue. When we talk about nail polish, we talk about a choice that we make, but the person who works to paint people's nails is being exposed to those chemicals all the time. So I worry much more about the people working in New Jersey pumping gas than I do about my own pumping gas for a few minutes, you know, once a week. So for sure, you could pay someone else to pump your gas, but in the end, we're making choices about dispersing chemical exposures to someone else. So something to keep in mind. Same thing with going to a nail salon.
If I can sort of add to that. So you talk about bodegas or community markets. So think about the cashier who's not making that much money giving you your slip. She is holding your grocery slip. So one of the things that we say is, you know, if you buy bananas, you're really not going to return them anytime soon. So not only don't, you know, say I don't want a slip if they don't provide it electronically, but tell that cashier or tell that attendant about, you know, wearing any kind of protection. Go in and talk to the manager. That's the way you can start to be an agent for change.
So the next question was, is weight or obesity taken into account with any of these other studies with the environment?
So So yes, human studies, when you're trying to find what's considered an association, so we very rarely can show that something caused something else. We can do that with DES because we purposefully expose people, but most of us are just environmentally exposed to chemicals. And when researchers are trying to find relationships between chemical exposures or any kind of environmental exposure and a disease, they will take into account things like age, they often take into account BMI, they will take into account race or ethnicity, socioeconomic status, educational status. All of those things do influence our environments and our exposure, so they're sort of wrapped up into the model. With rodents, it's kind of the beauty of working with rodents is that they do what we tell them to do. So, and they don't have a choice. They're compliant patients versus most humans are not. So some of the work that Karen was talking about that's going on at Michigan State, they're purposefully manipulating how much fat is in the diet of the animals. And so they can actually purposefully produce obese animals and see that it in fact often will drive the development of cancers. So I'm not sure if that exactly answers the question of how involved is obesity, but of course it's important for understanding the relationship between exposures and bad outcomes.
Okay, the next question is about the Orange Guard. Somebody wants to know, do you spray it directly on things or put it next to the soil?
Say that again, the what?
With the Orange Guard?
Oh, the Orange Guard.
Yes.
Oh, okay, great. Orange Guard is a very powerful odor. So you can spray it on like a rag or a paper towel and then just wipe it. I wouldn't recommend just like freely like spraying open because your house may smell like an orange grove for quite a while. So use it sparingly, but it is effective.
The next is sort of an advocacy question. How can we help to pressure the EPA and FDA and those kinds of things? What's the best way to do that?
Okay, so I'll start and say by joining groups that are already formed that are focusing on issues that can be corrected by the EPA, joining groups that are focusing on the issues that can be directed by the FDA, joining an environmental group or a disease focus group that has an advocacy arm. But writing a letter, speaking to your local official about something that concerns you or concerns your family or concerns your community, and teaming up with one other person, looking at the science, maybe going and making some phone calls so that when you go and you talk to the elected official, they can't say, aha, got your moment. You come with simple science, you tell them that you vote in their district, and then it moves on up from there.
I also want to add that we are part of the Just Green Partnership, which are 15 health and environmental organizations, and they work very diligently on getting bills introduced. And so there are a few bills. One is a bisphenol-free bill. So not just bisphenol AFS, whatever, but bisphenol-free for children's products 3 and under. And also there's a whole push for cleaning products to be on, the green ingredients to be on a New York State website, so that we can view what's in these products, because federal law does not ask for cleaning products to disclose this on their labels. So that is going on, and then also a cosmetic ingredient disclosure website is also coming down the pipe as well. So these are things that you can call up your own legislators and say that you know you would like for them to co-sponsor these bills.
A lot of the problems actually are regulated by state. So you don't have to think in terms of, you know, am I making a trip to Washington anytime soon? It can be a county thing, it can be a state thing. And Laura spoke about this, if anybody saw this in yesterday's Newsday, this is what Laura spoke about. So it was quite a while ago that members from the Just Green Partners and New York State Breast Cancer Network, before that, this has been ongoing, we want a guideline as to what is in our household cleaning products. We've been promised it since the 1970s. So this article, which came out yesterday in Newsday, said we're still waiting to see those promised guidelines. So here it is, something in the state. You can call up your elected official and say, give us the guidelines. Let us know what we're purchasing. We want to be wise consumers. And guess what? Our dollars will drive the market.
Karen, what page?
It is in top story, page 8, A8. It's an A story.
Okay, one last, well, we have two last questions. They wanted to know if you said saran wrap was unsafe.
Okay, all right. I'm not mentioning any brand names.
Plastic wrap.
Plastic wrap, exactly. Plastic wrap can contain phthalates, and that's an endocrine disruptor. Look for phthalate-free plastic wrap. Actually, Whole Foods, like I mentioned, the positive issues related to products, they actually carry a product that is a plastic wrap, and it's phthalate-free.
Great. So this is another advocacy, more of a statement, that Suffolk County has a pesticide phase-out committee and a cancer prevention committee, and is forming a single-use plastic reduction committee. This is just encouraging the women in Nassau County to organize and get behind that for the county. So that kind of leads off what you were saying.
Well, Suffolk County over the years, and I've spent a lot of time in Suffolk with this woman, they really are very progressive, and I would say, I live in Nassau County, and I wish our county was a little more progressive on these issues. We have gone down there and spoken to various legislators and shown up when issues do come up, but there's not enough of them. There's not as many as a Suffolk.
And the last one is they want to know where they can get a copy of the slides. And one of the things we've done in the past is we put them on our website. So people can watch the video and follow them. Is that something that would be okay? So that we all have one place where all of the slides are? Is that okay with all of you?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, great. So you can find all the slides for tonight's talk along with the video that will be on our YouTube page on our website, which is breastcancer-cancer.adelphi.edu. And it's on all of our information that's on the table, so you can grab it there.
I have the last word.
Yes. Well, I might say one thing after you. Oh, yes.
I mean, sometimes sitting through these talks feels very overwhelming. Right? Like, we just told you about what you put on your body, what you use on your lawn, what you put in your house, what you, right? All of this, like, it feels very overwhelming. And the point is not to raise your anxiety. It's to raise your awareness. And I often find that people fall into one of two camps. One is they go home and they throw everything out, right? And we make no money for this, but also it's generally not the point, right? The stuff is gonna go in a landfill. So it's to make better choices moving forward, right? And changing one thing is a lot easier than change, right? It's like a crash diet. Oh, I'm never gonna eat another donut again. Yes, you will. So, you know, one thing at a time and taking control over your life, it's actually very empowering rather than very fearful. The alternative is people, and this happens mostly with young people, is they like throw their hands up in the air and they're like, literally everything is killing me, so why would I do anything about anything, right? Well, this is an opportunity to put tools in your hands, and they are your tools to use. And I am always fearful. I'm not an advocate, right? I'm a scientist. I study chemicals, but I'm still not a chemist. And oftentimes people will then say, you know, do we really want you to come to our baby shower? You're going to judge me, right? And that's not the point. So I do all kinds of things that I also shouldn't do, right? I use products that I should phase out of my own life. So this is about giving you power and tools. Ultimately, from my perspective, this perspective of a scientist, this shouldn't be your job to do. And that's why your voice, not in the supermarket, not when you're going to buy lawn care products, but your voice to your legislators is what's really important, because we should not have to be chemists to go shopping. It's just, this is not sustainable. So that voice is the voice you should be using, and you are so powerful. Your voice matters.
Thank you so much, Dr. Evaluations and hand them back to any of the staff members that are standing around. And please, for those of you who are new, put down things that you want to see, because we really follow what the people who come to our and say. That's how this came about.